آله وصحبه أجمعين. So I welcome you for the fourth session and last of today. We have 2 hours, inshallah, to discuss. So the floor is open. So we will take a first round of about five questions, maybe, and go on like this. Yes. So do you think we take one question and we reply immediately?
Yeah,
okay, that's okay. That's okay. We will take question by question.
Yeah. Am I allowed to go first?
Okay. My question is directed towards your talk earlier. So you said the zone of non-being. You have subhuman and non-human, essentially. And my question is towards the zone of being then, like. In light of things like honorary white people or white people who are oppressed, are there also levels in the zone of being where somebody can be like more mega being, for example?
That's a fantastic question. Thank you.
Are we doing only one?
Yes. Because that was proposed by them.
Yes.
Okay. So let me say the following. In the zone of non-being, you know, I was mentioning how you have divide and rule. So always the colonizers try to put one against the other, and making historical narratives that are very problematic. You have from the idea brought to Muslims, you know, brought to blacks in Africa and the Caribbean. Look at this. This is very interesting. In the Caribbean, they tell the Caribbean black people that the cause of their calamity into slavery and all of that is because Africans sold them. In Africa, they tell sub-Saharan Africa that the problem of their problems is due to Arabs, Muslim civilization, colonizing, slavery, etc. Okay? And then two Muslims, they're basically saying, oh, you know what? Black people are not good, are inferior. You know, so you have all this narrative between the people, everybody's below the line of the human, and then you have this Eurocentric narrative about our brothers and sisters in the zone of not being, you know, pulling us in different directions and looking at each other like enemies, almost like enemies. And when you look at the history, I mentioned the decision to enslave Africans at a mass scale and brought them to America, it was not African decision. That was the decision after the trial of Las Casas and Sepúlveda that I mentioned the first day, when they decided to put indigenous people into the encomienda that began here in the conquest of Al-Andalus, the encomienda, because they thought they were barbarians to be Christianized. After that trial, then who is going to do slave labor in America? That's when they decided to bring Africans in mass number. It was not the Africans who decided that. It's not that there were Africans selling. It was that they went there and kidnapped. They put an enterprise of kidnapping people and putting them in boats by force and enslaving America. This is what happened. But then, of course, to divide and rule, they put all this narrative. You Caribbean people got here because the Africans sold you. You Africans are here in this situation because the Arabs and the Muslims have been the most cruel empires and so on and so on. So all these narratives are, in my opinion, Eurocentric narratives that are playing in the hands that have been constructed, okay, in the past century to precisely divide and rule. Okay, now in the zone of being, okay, which is your question, I include there. You could say there is a hierarchy inside. Okay. So you have, when I say the West, for me, this is a positionality in power relation. It's not a geography, okay? So the West could be a westernized elite in Africa with a black face. The West could be a brown-faced Muslim elite in the third world. The West could be a Latin American leader of a country in Latin America with a white face or a brown face. You see, the West is not a geography. The West is a positionality in a global racial ethnic hierarchy. And what happened is that you have the West and the rest, not only in terms of North-South, but also inside the South, you have the reproduction of West, non-West, okay? And what happened is that then you have the westernized elites that in relation to the northern elites, they are below, you see? In relation to the northern elites, they are looked at, you know, with contempt. But they are the intermediaries of this global system of power, the intermediaries between the populations exploited in the third world and the global elites, okay, of the global north. You see, and that, and they are westernized elites, fundamentally because of the position they occupy, and because they become, in that structure of power, they reproduce again the question about the racism as it was defined this morning. Okay, and so they reproduce that in terms of their own population. Even if you have Western elite with a black face or brown face, or you see what I mean? I want to break away from the idea that the West and the non-West is a geography. It's not a geography. This is a major misunderstanding. It's a positionality in power, racial ethnic hierarchies at a world scale, and therefore, to answer your question, there are, within that zone, there are also hierarchies, and there is oppression inside that zone. There are people oppressed by class. There are people oppressed by gender. There are people oppressed by all kinds of issues, okay? What is common to the zone of non-being, oh, I'm sorry, to the zone of being, is that despite the oppression, they live privilege because they live racial privilege. What does that mean, racial privilege? It's related to what I discussed this morning, the materiality of domination. Has to do first with access to codes of regulation, access to law, because for the oppressor there, those people that are oppressed there are seen as human. The humanity is not in question. Therefore, there is an extension of labor rights, civil rights, human rights, women's rights, you name it. And there is also an extension of emancipatory discourses, recognition of freedom, liberty, autonomy, individual freedom, and so on. Okay? But what happened in the zone of non-being is that the materiality of domination do not recognize the humanity of those subjects. And so you have also class oppression, gender oppression, all the oppression we can imagine, okay? But aggravated by racial oppression. You see the point? So in that zone, the aggravated by racial oppression is related to the materiality of domination. Because the humanity of those people are not recognized, then they don't have access to regulation, that is access to rights, and they don't have access to emancipatory discourses. So the way to manage conflict is through dispossession and violence. This is the methods that are privileged in that zone. And that's why, and I repeat again, racism is one of the fundamental problems in the world today. And to say that this is secondary or this is irrelevant is really very problematic, you know, for the reason we discussed this morning. You know, and this is tied to colonial history. You cannot say colonialism is over. Because those structures of power put in place over centuries of European colonial expansion did not disappear with the arrival of so-called independent nation states. By the way, the notion of nation state is already very problematic. It's part of the problem, not part of the solution, as Tariq mentioned here and other people have mentioned here, okay? So this is what I will answer to that. There is a hierarchy that people oppress inside the zone of being, but what they share is racial privilege. You see, in the zone of non-being, there are all the same oppression, but aggravated by racial oppression. Is that clear? Anyway.
Yes. My question is to Dr. Ray. Yes, I understood what you were telling us about putting welfare programs in place for the laborers and everything, but in Qatar, I'm sure you already know this, there is a big issue of wasta. If somebody knows contacts, yes, you're not gonna make business with these companies unless they sign the terms and conditions. But there's an important issue of wasta that if these companies, the head of the company or the local guy who owns the company knows a guy from the royal family or from somebody important in the country, they can get away with all these penalties and these things. So I want to know if you're putting any laws to tackle these issues or in these terms and conditions. I know it's a big issue in Qatar, but I honestly think that it might cause problems because if they sign agreements with these companies saying, yes, yes, we'll sign, but then the WASTA will play a role and we can get away with it. That's a big disaster.
What is WASTA means?
I don't know.
It's influence.
Connection. Somehow, connection. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Thank you. Before I answer it, I have to make a retraction of what I said earlier about Islamophobia. I was not serious to get rid of the term Islamophobia. It's a very important one. I support it. It was kind of tongue-in-cheek about this this French poll issue. So let me just clear that up. So please don't think that I'm calling for the abolition of the concept of Islamophobia. Not at all. I support it. Okay, so your point is a good one, and let me answer it this way. That the program that we're trying to putting into place is in relation to the workforce, the migrant workforce. Now, what occurs between a company tendering for a contract, right? With its a contractor and its subcontractor. It's usually actually the subcontractors who are bringing in the migrant workers. When that occurs, if there is a WASTA system occurring at the executive level, whereby somebody is saying, give the contract to this company, that will probably be out of our purview. In other words, we won't see that. But with regard to the ethical principles, that is the mandatory standards, that is still going to operate. So regardless of whether WASTA is being used to get the contract still has to have built into it the mandatory standards. And the mandatory standards, well, I was going to say ensures, but I keep having this doubt in my mind. Should ensure that at least the workers, the poorest, low-skilled workers, are not paying for it. It will be paid for through the company, between the company and the local national who is going to be the sponsor, and so on. That will occur between them, and the company can build in that money to its tender costs. But it won't go back to the workers, because all of the other bribery chain comes from workers. That will dry up if the workers are not paying these recruitment fees. So in effect, it should not affect the welfare standards of the workers. It will happen at a tertiary level.
Right. Let's hope so.
I hope so, yeah. I can't see it any other way. Yeah.
Yes.
I actually have another question for you, Dr. Ray, relating more to the first presentation and first lecture that you made with regards to immigration as a general topic. I just wanted to have your point of view with regards to the immigration strategies that are being put in place in the West in general, and more specifically in the Europe countries, such as France, for example, whereby they are being in between situations, meaning that the right-hand political parties, for example, are claiming for closing completely the borders, saying that immigration is not something that the country needs in substance, and that the job market is primarily deemed to the French citizens, and some others that are claiming or proning for the priority and saying that we go for a selective immigration, meaning that we are only going to grant visas and the citizenship only for certain people that have very specific skills. Just wanted to know where is your opinion, what is your opinion in that respect?
Well, in short, that is the direction of most of the developed countries. That's exactly what they're all doing the same thing. They're restricting the issues of Islamophobia, and they're all built in. They want to be absolutely selective. That's the whole issue of migration now has been securitized and is an intelligence security issue. the data. You have, let me tell you, I mean, there is an organization called the International Organization for Migration that was established in 1952. It was established and it was initiated by the US government. Every director general of that organization has been nominated by a US president, and it has been an American, either a former ambassador and so on. That organization is worldwide and has been getting larger and larger and larger. Its mission, it is not part of the UN. It would like to be, but it's not. It is actually a for-profit organization worldwide. Its motto is the management of migration. It wants to be an organization that manages migration across the world. And as it attempts to do so, it will gather data on all migration flows and individuals. It has done experiments with setting up data banks. For example, they did one in Egypt because of the Egyptians trying to get across into Italy in these boats and all the illegal migration. They came to a deal where they went to Minya and they decided to, where there were a large number of people going from there, particularly young people. And they got all their names and addresses and their profiles and so on, put it on a data bank, and then they were going to match that with the employers wanting labor in Italy. It was a complete disaster because they just lied about their qualifications and skills and they didn't do it well. But it's the kind of thing that there are organizations that want to do this management of migration on a global level, but it's not really working. Nobody has a mandate to do that. The UN, but none of the UN organizations can do that. The ILO is a toothless tiger, but it comes up with terrific conventions and principles. It attempts to influence governments and so on. But in my view, just like all those other international organizations, they're very statist oriented, and they missed the opportunity that the Qatar Foundation actually found to bring about some serious change through the commercial influence. So I don't think there is a grand plan. As nation states, always looking to their own constituencies, trying to understand how they will get votes, I mean, and the ascendancy of the right and the racism and the xenophobia and Islamophobia and so on, is on the ascendancy. And I can never dissociate that with the objectives of Zionism, because they are there all the time and everywhere in all countries, seeking influence for what is in Israel's interests, which in many cases is chaos and mayhem. So I don't think there's a grand plan, but what's very, very clear, the demographers have made it very clear, and the projections to the future is that the European population, low fertility rate, and they need to bring in migrant workers, but they will be very, very selective. They've been doing it for years now, for at least 5 or 6 years, pouring money into research and data banks. They're funding a big data bank on migration in Florence, right, with colleagues of mine there. They're building this data bank to understand where they are going to get labor from at different levels, from low-skilled, medium-skilled, and high-skilled, and so on. But it will be under certain conditions. The conditions will be what they call circular migration. And in fact, circular migration for them is not unsimilar or dissimilar to what's occurring in the Middle East. The kafala system is kind of similar to what they actually were very appreciative of the kafala system. Why? Because they do not want to bring in workers on a permanent basis of permanent settlement and citizenship rights and so on. So they want to bring them in for specified periods of time, then they go back, and then they come back again. So that keeps them temporary. They do not want the disaster of the Gastarbeiter in Germany, where they had to accept many millions of Turks to remain with their families and so on and so forth. That's what they want to avoid. So this circular migration, they're They are advertising it as a win-win-win, everybody wins, you know, it's that kind of nonsense, but that's the plan.
Who is next?
This is Beret. You mentioned an effort to accredit ethical recruitment agents. I was wondering if you could just say a little bit more about that.
Yes. There's an organization that is, I think, based in Canada, but it's worldwide, called Verité. And they have been brilliant in the work that they have done on all of these issues, particularly from a commercial perspective. They were the ones that were involved with Nike and Apple and so on, and the corporate social responsibility, but really in there deeply, and providing guidelines for how ethical recruitment and treatment of workers ought to be from a corporate perspective. And they are well down the track already in how to identify ethical recruitment agencies. But they are, in conjunction with somebody else in the Philippines actually right now, who are drawing up the accreditation criteria by which these recruitment agencies will be accredited as ethical recruitment agencies. Then, once that is developed, then the organizations like the Qatar Foundation or the Q22, whoever, are contracting out for these projects, will then be able to offer preferred suppliers. I mean, organizations like that, these are the clients of the Qatari state, they, as a matter of course, provide corporations with preferred suppliers. So this will be preferred labor suppliers, which will be new, but it'll be preferred labor suppliers. They have to be accredited as ethical recruitment agencies. This is still going to take time. We are talking about a complete market restructure along ethical lines. It's not going to be easy, but the plan is there and the principles are there. So that's how it's going to work. And Verité are about to be contracted as a consultant to the Qatar Foundation, actually, in assisting.
Just regarding the ethical, like now when you are putting the laws to make sure that, for example, these agencies treat them in a justice way, like, but still regarding the ethical dimensions, when this like comes as a contract, especially in houses for the maids to serve in the houses, still I think we need, because you can guarantee everything, but the treatment, the ethical treatment in the house, I think it has to build within the humans. And I think you mentioned very important statement like Muslims torturing or exploiting Muslims. And I think this, it's very important here to mention, many Muslims, they justifies their treatment with this, humans who comes as on contract, but they treat them as slaves. And they find justification in the history of the Islam that we have slaves and there are rules, and like even they justify having sexual relationship with them, like they can have as jariya or something. And even some of them, of the workers themselves, they accept that. So I think it's just working on the legal dimension. We have also to work on the religious dimension, because when the scholars, religious scholars, enhances the education and especially for the religious leaders in community to spread the knowledge and education about the Muslims, about this is very important, because what you guarantee in on papers is not applicable if it doesn't come out of the hearts of the people themselves.
That was beautifully put, and thank you very much. You're absolutely correct. What I also should have said is that I always keep the issue of domestic work separate. It is a unique occupation in the world, and have very similar stories all around the world. It is a contemporary phenomenon of middle class people around the world employing domestic workers in larger and larger numbers. And there are many studies from different parts of the world showing very, very similar circumstances. So we need to separate what I was talking about with regard to the construction workers is very different. We have not put into place anything with regard to domestic workers. And the new standards do not apply to domestic workers. First of all, domestic workers are excluded from labor law. They have no labor law protection, you see. And that's a long historical fact in all the Arab states. They're excluded because the relationship as an employment relationship is not recognized. It is seen as a personal relationship. And in many ways, it becomes that, but sometimes too personal, right? And so there are many dynamics that operate with regard to domestic work and women working as domestic workers that you can't do it. Exactly what you said. You have to change the attitude, the culture, the hearts and minds of people who treat domestic workers as employees within the household without the brutalization and the demeaning and so on, all the things that they do, which are many. So that indeed is what has to change. But that is not an easy process. And we've done a number of things in Lebanon in an attempt to do that, but it's still a long, long way off. And maybe in the end it's not possible because there is a certain frame of mind, and maybe we really should start thinking about the next generation. And as I said to somebody earlier on, really for these sorts of things you need to target 12-year-old girls, right, and educate 12-year-old girls for the future, and so on, because you have generation after generation growing up with domestic workers, and children can be just as brutal with their domestic workers as their kafil, right? And we've seen this, and that's not always acknowledged. Yeah. So thank you very much.
Connecting to this question is that I think there is an entanglement here between race and class that becomes complicated in a sense the situation, in the sense that today, in the world we're living, we cannot think anymore of class as insulated from racial hierarchies. Because a lot, you see more and more the stratification of the labor force across ethnic racial lines. That is, you will see particular group of people coming from a particular place in the world doing certain kind of labor in another part of the world. And you could see this stratification going on in many places, including, of course, the countries that you are targeting, in this case, Qatar and other, oil monarchies of the Middle East. But you could see it also in India, you could see it in, you could go to Brazil, for example, you could go to many parts of the world. It's this phenomenon, it's a global phenomenon. And that's why I insist that the problem of racism and coloniality is not anymore a geography, because you will see a lot of people in the third world, the westernized elites of the third world, doing exactly what the colonizers used to do in the past. But now they are kind of the link in the global chain between the global north and the southern labor.
Let me respond to that if I can. I mean, I have written about this, and in fact, it's a. There's been one argument. One of the key writers very early on wrote a book called Contract Slavery. And he was the founder of Anti-Slavery International in London. Now, he argued that it's not race. He argued that it is poverty. His argument was that it's a question of poverty. That's what's driving this. Now, I think that that's an important point. But I think there are other elements too. I agree with you. It's racial. It's class and status, and it's gender.
Yeah.
Because with domestic work, it is essentially a gendered occupation. So. It's an occupation for females. And so typically, it never ceases to amaze me that over in the West, everywhere, that despite equal opportunity legislation, affirmative action programs for women, and so on, you still see that women are still of this new generation still making decisions to go into occupations that are traditionally female occupations, and males going into traditionally male occupations. I look at the registration figures of my university or universities, and I see where people are enrolling in which departments, which courses, and it's clear it's still the old way. You know, how many women are registering to become engineers and electricians? I mean, it's still standard. And so it's caring work. And typically, when the caring work comes into practice, whether it's caring for children or the elderly or the sick and whatever, it's women who do that. Whether it's at a professional level or whether it is at a non-paid or a voluntary level or so on and so forth. So there is a gender, race, and class and status. From India,
You could apply the same notion that you're applying to domestic labor also to, you could say, the global labor today.
Absolutely.
If you look, for example, at the maquiladoras, how do you say that in English, the sweatshops in the third world, okay? And this brings me back to a concrete example of zone of me, non be. You could be a worker in the Boeing company or a worker in the Airbus company, where earns 150 euros a week? No. A day? No. An hour, okay? Those workers have access, because they are exploited in the zone of being, they have access to labor rights, they can do a demonstration, they can do go to the court against their corporation, they can do a strike. They know that they can come back home that night alive, okay? Now, 90% today of the labor force in industrial manufacturing labor are fundamentally women, third world women. That is, there is the gender and racial articulation there, 90%. And in those sweatshops, they earn $2 an hour? No. Or $1 an hour? No, a day, okay? So they work 8 hours a day? No. 14, 16 hours a day. They have a problem with their owner of the company? Do they go to strike? Do they go to put the case against the owners in a court of law? No, because there, the way the system manages conflict is through violence and dispossession, and they know that if they do a strike, a manifestation, or they go to court, their life is at stake. They know their life is at stake, because the way the conflict is managed in those spaces is through violence. And so the question of dispossession and violence becomes a fundamental a form of domination in zones of not being. And you see here the difference between being a working class exploited in the zone of being and being a working class exploited in the zone of not being. In the zone of being, you have access to a material income, to labor rights, to a discourse of emancipation, equality, etc., that collapse in the zone of not being, because the humanity of those women, third world women, women of color, are not recognized in the eyes of the corporation, and therefore they are submitted to forms of violence that are you don't see in the same way as the zone of being. In the zone of being, there are fundamentally ways of administering conflict more through peaceful means, regulation, emancipation, with exceptional moments of violence. There is violence, but as an exception. In the other zone, you have violence as a norm, as an everyday, with exceptional moment of a peace, or no, of regulation, emancipation. It's the invert. So this, I think, happens a lot with migrants. migrants enter space, and you were describing very well this morning, how a lot of these migrants, they don't have access to citizenship rights. They don't have access to labor rights. There are many things that are overlooked in the process that, in my definition, at least of racism, I see it as how you could see there how racism becomes an organizing principle of the political economy as well as gender. That is, you see how these things are not just like the old Marxist rhetoric that they used to be superstructure, how they are organizing capital accumulation from within, you know? And so in that sense, and this is the concept of coloniality that we're using to talk about how this Western modern world has created structures of domination that are entangled with the political economy in ways that are really, in my opinion, very original and new in relation to the old world or other social systems. Not that there were better worlds, just that in the past, you could see forms of domination that were different from these ones that I've been calling racism, okay? And so this is why I emphasize in the question of racism as a fundamental structuring logic of the political economy. And you could see that not only in the global north, but in countries of the global south. You could see that like he's describing. I mean, the process you're describing is a process of inferiorization of people, dehumanization of people, you see, that is happening in a country that is supposed not to be northern, western, European or American or Western country, you see, but it's happening there, and this is why I use the term westernized elites, because westernized elites could be doing the same thing, even though they might be Muslim, they might be Hindus, they might be have a black face, brown face, it doesn't matter. They're occupying the position of the colonizer in that space, you know, that now today is being administered through this West and the Rest structuring, even though you don't have any more the old British or the old, French colonizer. Now you have local elites westernized and doing the job, okay, that used to be done in the past by other people, okay, and with a different culture. It doesn't have to be the same culture. But here is where the question of decolonization becomes also internal to the cultures that are colonized in the third world, including to traditions such as Islam or such as other traditions. We need to look inside also to see how our own, the thing the sister was describing, how our own tradition has been affected by that history. And now you are trying to find, you know, ways of justifying halal capitalism, ways of justifying, halal slavery, ways to justify, and so on, you know? And so this is a form of, here you see Western modernity, and this is the point that why it happened was emphasizing so much on that side. Western modernity coming to now transform many things that, yes, they were there in the past, but not in the way they exist today, okay? And this shift in discontinuities in history, we need to account for. We cannot just say, oh, you know, Islam has slavery since the past, etc., and not take into account that these forms of coerced labor that exist today have particularity, have nothing to do with that past.
By the way, the Gulf states only abolished slavery in the 1960s.
Wow.
So, in fact, it's still in living memory. But what's interesting here also is the way in which this movement of labor can also be couched in liberal economic terms. That is, it's the marketplace that determines, it's the laws of supply and demand and the invisible hand that is determining who's chosen and who's not. It's a nonsense. What you're also describing is what Michael Piore described as the segmented labor market theory, that is a dual labor markets. Primary labor markets, primary jobs are secure, permanent, well paid, right? While the others are insecure, precarious jobs, badly paid, and so on. There's no one market. It's a nonsense the way in which liberal economics, economic theory presents this idea of a labor market that abides by the laws of supply and demand, which they argue is based upon the price mechanism, that is, the level of wages will determine where people will go. And that's been adequately debunked by all the left and anybody even slightly left to show what a nonsense it is. Yet, it is extremely influential in formulation of government policy and has been since the Reagan-Thatcher period, which has decimated the trade unions that provide collective bargaining because individuals don't have that power, and so on and so forth. This has been, it's just been getting worse and worse and worse, increasing poverty, increasing powerlessness and desperation of that poverty, where people will undertake whatever they can get. And they'll buy into these circumstances. They'll take incredible risks. Many have perished on their way to try to find a job. They're drowning and they're being killed and all sorts of things. It's pretty awful. And the more the securitization, the more that governments want to be selective and prevent certain people from coming in, the more they're going to try to get in illegally, and the more vulnerable they are to all of those forces, not to mention mafia, crime organizations that prey on these kinds of vulnerable people.
I have two questions. The first one is about models to deal with immigrants throughout the Muslim history, especially maybe in the Ottoman Empire, when there was certainly constant influx of new people, I wouldn't say immigrants, but at least new people into the sphere of the Ottoman Empire, and how they dealt with it. And if there are any conclusions which are fruitful for the current current discussion.
You heard me already. You heard me talking the other day how I refuse to use the term empire. Okay. Yeah. If you use the term empire for the Ottomans, then you have to allow me to use the term sultanate for the British. Okay. So, because it's really very Eurocentric to just extrapolate concepts that come from a local history and make them universal. So we call Aztec Empire, Inca Empire, Ottoman Empire, Chinese Empire, everything that moved around the world, empire. But that's ridiculous. It's as ridiculous as saying British Sultanate, French Sultanate, Aztec Sultanate, Inca Sultanate, and you get the point, Chinese Sultanate. It's, you're taking a particular form of political authority from the local history of Europe and making it universal. So I'm saying that because precisely what you are saying, because there are other models of political authority in history that we're going to just erase, you know, in a very flattened down, you know, in a second if we take this kind of concepts. Because precisely what you're saying is, if you look at the Ottomans, you could see how the way they manage the question of diversity and the question of minority rights have nothing to do with modern forms of nation state, okay? For example, I can tell you now that Jews in Palestine under the Ottomans have more rights, more political autonomy, and more resources, okay, than what Palestinian Christians and Palestinian Muslims have today under the Zionist state, okay? Where is that coming from? Well, this has to do, if you say this anywhere in the world today, it's a scandal. How could you say that the caliphate is a scandal, you know? In some places you can be accused of collaboration with terrorism for saying what I'm saying. Believe me, this is the case, you know? So this is the kind of thing that we need to, this is why we cannot take the concepts of local European history and the Eurocentric narratives for granted and becoming the tools through which we're going to filter, you know, with the lenses of Eurocentrism, what happened in the world and in history. Because there are models there, like the one you're just describing, that allow you to think about alternatives, to think about minority rights, etc. With all the problems, all the critique we can make, okay, of the Ottoman, because there's many, And I believe that part of their decline was what Hatem was saying. Well, he was saying this morning in the other course, not here, but he was saying this morning in the other course how they start trying to imitate the West in the 19th century, thinking that part of the problem of the Muslim world was that they were not developing enough in technology and science, when in fact, what was happening was a shift in global power relations because of the expansion to the Atlantic of the Europeans, that then, with the gold and silver coming from there, devalued all the wealth of the Muslim civilization. That's a point made also by Enrique Dussel. You know, so if you understand those shifts in power, global power relations, you don't understand what happened to Muslim civilization, you see? And what happened is that they start taking for granted Western modern discourse that what made the West uprise was some kind of intrinsic knowledge that made them develop science and technology. And so they start imitating this and then getting rid of some of the positive things that they were already had there and destroying it or leaving them behind, thinking that by embracing science and technology, they will be catching up with the West. In fact, it not only didn't happen, it ended up in the destruction of the Ottomans, that you could see that destruction even before the First World War, even before you have the war, that there was already, you know, the collapse of the Ottomans, you know, and this is also part of the fascination of Western modernity, imitating the West, you know, without taking into account the historical sociology that has produced the decline of one and the uprise of the other. You see, the rise of the West, you cannot understand it without the domination and exploitation exercised by European colonial expansion. It was through the slavery in the Americas that you have all this wealth that allowed for the industrialization of Europe in the 19th century. Without that, those connections, it just, you cannot make sense of why Europe suddenly uprise, you know, and develop to that extent. It's because of the colonial expansion, the imperial structure, domination, exploitation of resources, extracting resources, exploiting labor from the rest of the world that allow Europe then to rise, to become highly industrialized, highly developed, etc. So this is something that we need to put at the center of the equation, you see, if we want to then think critically about, okay, what exactly happened in the Muslim world. Because if there is the tendency, we don't take into account that history in a serious way, to think that the problem are the Muslims. And if you think the problem are the Muslims, you lose sight completely of the broader structures of power that have plundered the rest of the world to give rise to the West, you see? And to develop the West. This is the concept of development of underdevelopment that you can see also in world system theory, dependency theory, etc. You know, where by underdeveloping someone else, you get the development of the global north, okay? So these structures are very important to understand. And then once you take that into consideration, then we can start looking, you know, in a more subtle and nuanced way, what exactly were the structures of internal structure that makes the Muslim world colonizable, you see? But the colonizability that the brother was mentioning yesterday of Malik Benabi is an important concept if we put it in the broader context of Western modernity and colonialism. If we put colonizability decontextualized from that, then it looks like, oh, the problem are the Muslims. That's why they were colonial, because there was some problem with them. No, the Muslims were, there was a broader structural problem. There were not just the Muslim, indigenous people in the Americas, people all over the world that were colonized by this power, okay? But the colonizability, these weaknesses, have to be understood within that context, because that also created certain fascination to Western modernity internally that then called for transformation that ended up the accelerating the demise of this other civilization. And I think that the Ottoman is a good example of the possibility of having forms of authority that are beyond the idea of the nation state. Because in the Ottoman, you know, there is a coexistence. There's no pretension of one state with one identity and one population with the same identity. That fictional pretension does not exist in the Ottoman. Today, indigenous movement in Latin America are moving beyond the notion of the nation state and proposing the idea of plurinational societies. and they have changed the constitution of Ecuador and Bolivia, okay, calling for, we are all inside one state, but multiple nations inside the state. And therefore, we need to enter into horizontal dialogues to see how are we going to live together without one deciding for the rest what is best for you. You see? How can we then construct pluriversal notions, okay, instead of universal, in which we can live and coexist inside one state? You see? So this is another way of thinking beyond the framework of the nation state. But in the past, we have good examples, I believe, like the Ottomans, with all the critiques and problems we can look at.
I have a question related to a hadith that came up to my mind, a wording of the Prophet ﷺ in an authentic hadith says, تَتَكَالَبُ عَلَيْكُمُ الْأُمَمُ كَمَا تَكَالَبُ الْأَكْلَةُ عَلَى قَسَعَتِهَا. So the nations will eat from you like people would gather and eat from a plate. And then the companions of the Prophet ask, أَمِنْ قِلَّةُ نَحْنُ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَا رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Will we be that few, that everybody just can eat from us like and do with us whatever they want? And the Prophet to reply, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ كَثِيرٌ. You will be a lot, وَلَكِنَّكُمْ غُثَاءٌ كَغُثَاءِ السَّيْلِ. But you will be like, الْغُثَاء is like something that is taking with water, with the flow, the kuma that is taking with the flow.
The flow.
Okay, so you understand what I mean? So here in this hadith, we can understand that the Prophet points that the cause, it's the Muslim themselves. So how would you understand this hadith in the light of colonization?
I would say that first we need to understand context of the revelation. Okay, we need to understand that the social system that existed at the time was not exactly the same that we're talking today. Okay, because that pre-Islamic civilization that existed before, with polytheism and with many problems with dominant classes, etc. You know, it was a form of, there were forms of political authority that were quite different, okay, from what you see after 1492 with Western modernity. Because in many of the pre-modern forms of political authority, there was not the pretension, okay, there was not the pretension of forcing people, okay, to be like them. You could have structural domination, but those structural domination will be, in a sense, have no problem how you pray, what language you speak, that kind of thing, okay? There was no imposition. That was not the logic of domination, or did not pass through that, okay? What happened, I think, with Western modernity, it got tied up with Christendom. Christendom, the way I described it in the first day, in which you have a structure of power that cannot acknowledge the possibility of unity with diversity, that can only be thought unity with as homogeneity, you see? In the pre-modern form of political authority, there was no pretension of that. You could see across the world, and in general, yes, there was domination, yes, there was, but the powers did not pretend that you would speak the same language. They might put a tribute to the tribe, that you have to pay this tribute, and in that way you've been dominated, or they might colonize a territory. You could see that over and over in many places. But the pretension that there would be only, only one spirituality, that didn't exist at that moment of the revelation. Today, we're living in a world, okay, where there is the pretension after 1492 of imposing whatever the Europeans colonized. They went with their language, they went with their pedagogy system, with their spirituality, with their knowledge, with their everything. It's not just that they're exploiting your labor. It's not that just they come in and exploit labor. It's that they're also imposing a form of life, a form of thinking, a form of praying, a form of, they go after everything, okay, in terms of the colonial project. So I would say that in the times of the revelation was a very different context from today, because what happened is that when Europeans colonized the Muslim world, they went after transforming Muslim spirituality. They were in the French, in the British, in the, you look and it's a systematic attempt at somewhere or another destroying Islam by transforming it into something different from what it was. And also into destroying the forms of production of knowledge, the production of the forms, their autonomy in terms of jurisprudence, etc. So you get attempts of all this colonizing to go in there. It's not saying, oh, you're Muslim, I respect you, okay, I will just exploit your labors. No, they go there and they go after everything, after, okay, how do you pray? What do you pray? Why do you pray? And, you know, and they try to transform all of that in the process of colonization. So we're talking about a very particular form of power, okay, that that in a sense has affected all the cultures of the world. Because it's not as if they will be respecting the way you are or the way you think. They will be going after the way you dress, the way you, what do you read, what language you speak, what and so on, transforming in a radical way the imaginary, the forms of living, forms of thinking, forms of praying, forms of how do you understand your culture. It's a major, major metaphysical catastrophe. It's a concept by Nelson, the one who spoke here at the end. Metaphysical catastrophe, this Western-centric colonial expansion, because it implies a form of power that is not just governing, it's also governing from you know, leaving your subjectivity intact. It's that it's going after your subjectivity. It's trying to target your soul, your heart, your subjectivity, etc., etc., etc. That's very different from forms of power in the past, okay? Because in the pre-modern times, most of the structures of power were not that interested in dealing with that. They were looking for other things, you know? But this form of power of Western modernity is going after the subjectivity of everybody. And that way, it has affected the internal structures of all the cultures, including Islam. So that's why you have this struggle in Islam today. You have a version of Islam that looks more like fundamentalist Protestants, okay, than anything else, okay, and so on. I mean, you could see these things going on. I give you another example in Morocco. In Morocco, I visited Morocco last month, invited there to give some lectures among the ulemas of Morocco. And one thing that I saw there was that different from other Muslim countries is that if you're not Muslim, you cannot enter a mosque, okay? So I was with some non-Muslims and they were not allowed to enter. So I was kind of surprised because in other parts of the Muslim world, you know, people are invited to enter and to know, etc. But there it was forbidden. So I asked the question, then they cited hadiths, etc., okay? And at that moment, it looks as something authentic in the way it's being justified. But if you look at history and you ask your question, when did this happen? Okay, since when this happened? Well, it was a French general in the 19th century that passed a law in Morocco forbidding non-Muslims from entering the mosque. For several reasons, I cannot go in detail now, but it was a French colonial law.
There's no hadith about this.
Yes, I know, but I'm telling you, what is the reaction? I start citing hadiths that are, you know, that, you see what I mean? Hadiths that are not, we know that they're not authentic, but I heard people citing hadiths, etc., justifying as some authentic thing. The point I'm trying to make is how this came out of a French colonial law that then later on slowly entered the culture, entered the habits, and then slowly it becomes to be justified with some kind of hadiths that etc. Okay, so this is just a metaphor. I'm just throwing this as a metaphor of what happened with Western modernity and coloniality. that this metaphor, what I'm telling you now about forbidding no money for entering the mosque that happened in Morocco, you could see the same thing happen with the epistemic structures. Just to get the point, how we begin to, things that became internalized into the tradition as if it's some kind of authentic form of Islam that later on people lost the memory of where things coming from, and suddenly you have people justifying it under the gaze of, you know, some kind of false hadith or whatever, okay? So, of something authentic. This is what I'm trying to say of why decolonization is not just fighting the structures of power, outer structure. It's also dealing with ourselves, our culture, our inner structures, our mentality, our spirituality that have been also colonized by that. And we need to also, to, that's why doing decolonization, and you said very well yesterday, at the end, this morning, is a major task. Because you need to know your tradition very well, you need to know the history of your tradition, you need to know the sources, you need to know colonial history, okay? You need to know the history, that colonial history in relation to the tradition and things that were kind of messed up by that Western modernity and colonization, and to be able to then take the grain from the, how do you say that? El grano de la paja. The grain from the
chaff. Grain from the chaff.
The grain from the chaff, and distinguish one from the other. So it's a major labor, major work to do that is in front of us. And this is a result of 500 years of Western modernity. We cannot claim that the tradition has been intact, you see, insulated from that history. The tradition has been also affected by that history, and we need to also open our eyes about things that today circulate authentic Islam that are coming from, you look back in history, only 150 years ago, and it's coming from the presence of the British or the French, or and transforming the tradition. I mean, we can go into the history in more detail, but anyway, I'll stop here.
Okay, I have coming back to my second question, actually. I have a question regarding contradiction and legitimacy in the area of racism. So we have discussed in the aspect of colonialism and racism that, okay, I would tackle it from a different angle. So what I find quite interesting is that nowadays I see a big contradiction within the human zone or those who construct the level of powers, that on the one hand we have strict definition of human rights, anti-discrimination rights, for example in the European Union just I think issued 1 year ago a very strict anti-discrimination rights in the labor field, not only including religion, sexual orientation, but even age. But on the other hand, as it was cited today in France, there are studies who say, okay, people get more xenophobic, Islamophobic, but less racist. So obviously, I think this system also produces a very strong contradiction of being racist on the one hand side, but trying to be universal and
ecumenical.
Okay. So, how does the system deal with this contradiction? And isn't there a chance, or there must be somewhere, a crisis of legitimacy somewhere? I think.
So I'm not quite sure how to respond to this. You go ahead.
Well, I think that there is, Eurocentrism is in terminal crisis. What do I mean by that? Eurocentrism, if you look at the first line of a Messerschmitt discourse on colonialism, I don't know how many of you have read that. You haven't read that, I invite you to read that. A Messerschmitt. I think you cited a Messerschmitt. No. Someone cited a Messerschmitt yesterday. Anyway, a Messerschmitt, the teacher of Franz Fanon. Remember? A Messerschmitt. The teacher of Franz Fanon, a Messerschmitt. In his little book called Discourse on Colonialism, he says in the first line, a civilization that cannot solve the problems it creates is a decadent civilization. A civilization that cannot solve the problems it creates is a decadent civilization. So what I'm trying to say is the following. Western modernity as a civilizational project, okay, that was successful as far as being able to destroy other civilizations, colonize them, and then we are today inside only one civilization. There's no other civilization outside this one, okay? So far, okay? That doesn't mean that in the future things will change, but now we are all inside this civilization, okay? So they were able to destroy the others, okay? So they are, the notion, these dualisms, for example, that I mentioned coming from the Christendom, no? That I mentioned the first day, is it impact the way this, the destruction of the notion of Tawhid, okay? That destruction created a new paradigm that is the dualistic paradigm, okay? I mentioned the first day the history of the destruction of Unitarian Christianism and turn it into a Trinitarian Christianism, the dualism, Constantine, Roman Empire, how it became, you know, the Christendom. I call that Christendom, not Christianity, okay? Christianity as ideology of power, transforming the theology and everything. So this, when it got secularized in the hands of people like Descartes or other people, okay? The whole dualism between the material and spiritual world turned into the dualism between man, nature. And man here, the gender is on purpose. That's how these philosophers talk about, okay? Man and nature. So man and nature is a dualism that is a secularization of material-spiritual split, okay? Man and nature means the following. Nature is exterior to man, to the human, okay? Nature is a means towards an end, right? I'm going to tell you something now. Any technology that you develop based on that rationality of nature as exterior to the human and a means towards an end have the seeds and the rationality of destruction of life. Because you have not thought of the fact that the human is not here, it's there, okay? Inside the cosmos, inside that tabu, that unity, okay? The human is there, it's not over here. And if you see this as a means towards an end, and you just destroy it, you're destroying life and the condition positive, not only of human life, but any form of life. And that's part of the disaster, ecological disaster, we're living today. It's coming from an epistemology that is a Western-centric epistemology, that is the secularization of Christendom, the Constantinian Christendom with the dualism that I mentioned the first day, okay? And today, if we want, part of the problem we face is that this civilization that is destroying life, okay, that is destroying life, not only human life that are put in the zone of non-being and so submitted to violence, like all the millions of people killed that I mentioned the first day and that yesterday Hatton mentioned in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in many places, okay? Millions of people killed, but also all forms of life that are at stake here. So we're talking about a civilization that is destructive of life. And that what happened today is the following. Coming back to your question. Eurocentrism is in terminal crisis. Why? Because they cannot give solution to the problem it had created. The first line of discourse on colonialism. What that means is, from the right, they have no solution except keep the same thing moving. From the left, they have no solution. Eurocentrism from the left, the westernized left, the Eurocentric left, they have no solutions. Every time they propose something, it becomes a global nightmare, okay? You have a socialism of the 20th century as a solution to this, it became a global nightmare, okay? The socialist project. The neoliberalism, a global nightmare. Anything they propose is a global nightmare. They don't have solution to the problem they have created. That's why today everybody in the Global South is now looking back to their own traditions and sources that they were told that they were unuseful, traditional, they were not modern, they're this, they're that. And while 40 years ago, movements of liberation in the third world were all Marxists, today they're all Aymaras, Islamic, Buddhist, or this or that. They're looking into their own non-Western traditional epistemology, looking for answers to the crisis of Eurocentric paradigms, of the right and the left. Because there, these traditions have answers to those problems. The best example I can give you was the Summit of Copenhagen. You remember the Summit of Copenhagen? They went there trying to deal with the global crisis, and they have no solution. It entered, that ended in a huge crisis, that summit. The response came 4-6 months later in the summit of Cochabamba in Bolivia. An indigenous president, Evo Morales, called indigenous people from all over the world and did a summit about the global ecological crisis. And they came with concrete solutions. And they came with concrete proposals that in the other summit, they have nothing to say. Why I'm saying this? Because like the brother said here this morning, in Islam, there is the potential also of having there the possibility of developing critical thinking into and solutions to the problems humanity faces today. But it has to be done with the humility of being one more in relation to many others. If we understand that Allah has sent many prophets to the world, we have to understand that there are also different traditions of spirituality in different parts of the world that are part of the same source, okay? And that allows, I think Islam has this potential of being able to develop these pluriversal dialogues instead of the universal of the West, the one that decides for you what is the best for you, right? In Islam, you have that potential because there is a recognition of all the prophets. You see, a recognition to the prophets of the other traditions as people sent by Allah, okay? And therefore, you can enter in dialogue and conversation in a different way, you see, in which you can have the dignity of people respected and thinking together about how are we going to go about solving the problems of humanity, you see? But only if Islam, or not Islam, Muslims, if we think of our tradition, not in this universalism of the West, but in this pluriverse as universe. You see, if we understand Dawit as diversity within unity, you see, and not Dawit as homogeneity within unity. If you say think of Dawit as homogeneity within unity, you just colonize it with this Christian-centric, Western-centric notion of universal, one that defines for everybody. But if you understand that Tawhid implies diversity within unity, you see, it allows the possibility and the potential to come up with very important dialogue that the world needs today, because we're facing a major crisis in terms of the survival of humanities and other species, not only human species. And so that's why I'm saying Eurocentrism is in a terminal crisis, and what we need now, for now and the future, is a decolonial twist. You see, a decolonial twist that will take seriously those epistemologies, those spiritualities that the Western modernity put on the side and inferiorize and marginalize, invisibilize. We have to bring that back in as a source of critical thinking to think about solutions about the problems and the injustices that are put in front of us today by this Western-centric, like, you know, modernity. So this is more or less the idea of the decolonial, no?
My question is directed to all of you. I was actually wondering if you could emphasize more on the what would be a possible Islamic response to tackle problems of migrant workers and citizenship.
Islamic citizenship.
Well, you know, I think that's a really important question. And it's a question of identity. When, if you're just going to talk about migrant workers generally, Migrant workers come from a whole range of backgrounds, Islamic, Buddhist, and so on. So one of the, there's a very insular attitude at the moment to, within the Gulf states, if that's what we're talking about, with regard to citizenship. They're very, very cautious and very, very protective of their wealth and of the rights of citizens and control of those nation states as they've been carved out. I don't see any real relaxation of that for the foreseeable future because of those kinds of vested interests. You're seeing very much, it's been going on for a long time, the idea of nationalization. In fact, policies, they call it Kuwaitization, Saudiization, Qatarization. That is to increasingly favor their own citizens. As their citizenry, in fact, grow slightly in population, they want to make sure that they are provided for first. And that's this insular attitude and mindset. And in fact, there have been massive deportations from Saudi Arabia recently. Since November last year, they have deported some 250,000 workers. Most of them Ethiopian women who arrived there and were irregular. They came through Yemen and they've sent them back, which has created a massive problem of integration back in Ethiopia for those people. I don't know about how one would present an Islamic argument for the granting of citizenship to foreigners in your territory. Right. I think there would be really conflicting arguments, probably, in attempting to do that. But maybe you could offer some more.
Yeah, I think that, you know, part of what happened again is that the whole issues are framed, again, within the institutions of this Western modernity. You get down the nation state as an institution, this pretension that, fictional pretension, that doesn't exist anywhere. That the identity of the state would correspond with the identity of the population. And therefore, those who deserve citizenship are the ones who have are part of that identity inside the state, right? And then people who have other identity, other coming from other backgrounds, etc., are usually seen as suspicious of being the national. So here you have a structure, a new structure of political authority that emerged in this Western modernity that did not exist in the past. In the past, there were other forms of political authority in which there was coexistence. I mentioned the example of Andalusia, coexistence of multiple spiritualities together, etc., identities, and there was under Muslim rule, and there was no pretension, okay, of, you know, the people who happened to be Jews or Christian or whatever to have to be Muslim to get some rights inside that territory, okay? And there was rights of minority, right, etc. Okay, so these are things that are in the history there as plausible tools to rethink the future. Not that we're going to go to the past, because that's impossible. We're not going to go to the past. But to think the future, that there are other possibilities, other models, like the brother was saying before. You know, there are other models and possibilities there. But the, as a Muslim, I take very seriously, you know, La ilaha illallah, okay? So for me, this is very serious. What that means for me is there's, you cannot submit to anything, you know, except Allah. The moment you're worshiping nation states, the moment you're worshiping citizenships, the moment you're worshiping economic systems such as capitalism and so on, you are just, you know, falling into the traps of shirk, okay? And so I think that we need to develop a decolonial outlook. We need to, as Muslims, to take very seriously that as a point of departure, because part of what happened in these, Muslim majority countries is that the state claimed to be Muslim, okay? But in fact, when you look at the forms of political authority, it had nothing to do, okay, with anything that you can imagine as being part of the Muslim tradition. What they have been doing is bringing modern political structures and finding ways in the tradition to justify, you know, what they're doing. You see, and that's why a lot of the ulemas and a lot of the jurisprudence today is, and not only that, even at Juma, the you know, in Friday prayers, what you hear is things are coming from states, because this is state control. State control. So you don't have even the space or the autonomy that the Muslim ulemas and Muslim and mosques used to have under Muslim rule. You remember, under Muslim rule, the ulemas were autonomous from political authority. They were not, the political authority would not enter there to tell you what to say in the Muslim Friday. This is all modern, Western modernity, as I told you before with your point. They're, you know, looking, touching not only your labor, etc., but touching your subjectivity. They're going after your soul. They want to shape the way you think, shape the way you feel, shape everything to make you a docile instrument, okay, for commodity consumption, for all kind of worshiping, you know, of. And so the problem we have is that there is a colonial Islam there, or a colonial Muslims, you know, that are reproducing a lot of these structures of power and then try to justify them, making shift and transformation in the tradition, okay, and finding the hadiths that nobody knows where they got them, okay, to justify, or then making fatwas. There's no ring, okay, let's make a fatwa. And here it is, you know, and so now you justify with the fatwas whatever you're doing, you know, that have nothing to do with Islam. Okay, so this is where I think this is where I see the decolonial playing an important role, to call attention to these things, but not to throw away the tradition. I'm not saying, hey, let's throw away the tradition, nothing is useful here. That's not what I'm saying. Is that we all have to enter into this critical dialogue from where we are and from those traditions that the Western modernity have been saying for centuries that they are inferior to them. We need to bring that back in a serious, systematic way, but at the same time being alert that today we cannot look at this in a naive way, because many of the of the tradition have been also touched in perverse way by that same Western modernity, and you don't need anymore the presence of a British colonizer or French colonizer in your country. Now you have it inside, in your soul, in your minds, in your culture. That is colonization of minds, colonization of culture, colonization of your soul. And now you begin to do, without having a ruler, a British ruler telling you what to do, everything that is now useful for the global system we're living in, you know? And so these kind of perverse forms of incorporation of labor that you're describing, you know, is part of the, you know, the same thing. And then if you don't have anything, you make a fatwa, okay? And then with the fatwa, you think you're justifying, you know, these things. And this is where I think we need to be very careful, very, very careful, you know, because a lot of things that seems to be, you know, authentically Islamic, not necessarily is. And that's where we need to have a very, very, how can I say, deep knowledge of the tradition and deep knowledge of history. The two things have to be together so we know what we're doing in this process of, of thinking Islam as a critical tool to find solutions to the challenge of humanity today. This is my answer to that. But anyway, you wanted to say something.
No, I was just going into an identity crisis. a necessary actual transition.
Was it identity?
You have the mic?
No. This works. You just said identity crisis, and Ramon was talking about dark ages of Islam. Of Muslims, but how you call it? Dark ages.
What I said was, that the Europeans invented the narrative of history to justify their superiority. And there is a moment that they jump from Greek to Roman and then to Dark Ages, Middle Ages, and then to the Renaissance. I'm saying that moment they call Dark Ages, Middle Ages has a name. And they cannot afford to name it because that will question the narrative of superiority of the West over the rest. And the name of that is Islamic Renaissance in Europe.
Yeah, and actually I want just to share, there was an exhibition, international exhibition, about the naming of this Dark Ages and to change the name and to call it Golden Ages, actually. And they made a movie, not a movie, like a trailer on it with Ben Kingsley. I don't know if some of you heard about it, but it's like just I wanted to share about the information, and I recommend the book which came out from this work, from this exhibition, which is named Muslim Heritage of Our Civilization.
Say it again. Heritage
Muslim Heritage in Our Civilization, and it's about all the inventions and all the Muslim work, Islamic work, and the impact it had on our civilization of today.
1001?
Yes, yes. 1001 inventions, exactly. So,
lost history.
Yeah. Also. Thank you.
Yeah, here at the back. Actually.
Long way to go, huh? I better meet you halfway.
Thank you. It's a really, really interesting talk. Certainly, I would say the community that I'm coming from has a long way to go and lacks the history and lacks the context. But trying to put a practical spin on that, how do we get the courses in our communities that, you know, can change that for the next generation? I mean, I'd like not to wait. My kids are grown. I have grandkids. I'd like not to keep waiting for somebody to, you know, provide these courses, but they're not there. You know, the context, pardon?
What about you?
I know, but I'm just saying, you know, for me to start to learn what this gentleman knows now, would take, like, it took him a lifetime to be so conversant in this. So, you know, my question to you was, do you have a website? Are there, how do we access some of the, you know, and it's got to really be, I think, I'm an educator, I teach teachers, so I think it's got to be kind of morsel size, kind of attractive. You know, for some reason, young people don't think history is interesting because I'm talking now Western public school system, you know. They don't think it's interesting because their teachers haven't made it interesting. And that's unfortunate, but we'd like to attract young Muslims to this deep history. And I'm just, you know, just begging your, your thought. Where do we start?
This is, I think, one of the major challenges we have in the UMA. I mean, what country are you coming from?
I'm coming from Chicago.
Okay, you're coming from Chicago. I
work actually with 250 Islamic schools in the United States.
Yeah, I mean, we are from the same country. I'm a colonized subject inside your country.
I'm coming from
the island of Puerto Rico.
I read your bio, but you didn't get to read mine.
So anyway, I understand your concern, and I think this is a major challenge, not just for Muslims in Chicago.
Sure.
This is a major challenge for Muslims everywhere in the world. You could be in a Muslim majority country and go to a school to receive the same Western-centric education that you hear in any other part of the world.
Yes.
And so this is really, I would say, problematic. Don't idealize, don't think that because you are in Chicago that you know, in Muslim majority country, you want to get something, maybe something better than what you have in Chicago, definitely, I'm sure, but it's not going to be that decolonial or that away from Western century. Part of what happened is that a lot of these narratives, historical narrative, Western centric narrative, this fascination with modernity, okay? And modernity, as I said, is a civilization of death. It's a civilization of death. We have nothing to be fascinated about that, okay? It's producing too much death in this planet. to be fascinated by this, okay? And so the point I'm trying to say is that, yes, so the point I'm trying to say is that in terms of structure of education, I think this is a challenge for the woman, you know, for all the woman. We have a challenge here, and that is, how are we going to decolonize ourselves from those you know, structures of historiography, or those historiographical narratives, okay, that we have internalized, you see, as kind of common sense, you know? And this is a major challenge. I can tell you something. There are Muslims in Granada here that have created their own schools, okay, here, Muslims in Granada. And what I find interesting in that, you remember the mosque we went, what I find interesting is that now, after three generations, now they have a generation like of 25 Hafiz, okay, with trained in Muslim education, with madrasas. They created madrasas here in Spain, and now in that mosque, you have a generation of 24, 25, 26-year-olds that are running the mosque. They are the ones running the mosque. They have newspaper. They are an imam of 26-year-old who is a Hafiz and who is fluent in Arabic, in English, in many languages, Spanish. You know, on Friday, he always speaks in Arabic and in Spanish, which give an access to the community. And now they have the project of creating a school that will teach alternative education, okay, not only to Muslims, also to non-Muslims. Sure, sure. You see? And so this is, I think, I see it as something small, you know, but attempting to address these challenges in the case of the West, okay? But in the right. case of Muslim minority countries, I think there are more possibilities there of, you know, in the sense of challenging this narrative, structural knowledge, in the sense of, it has to come from the woman. If it doesn't come from the woman, there's no change that is going to happen in Muslim majority countries.
But that's my question, actually. You know, how do we change that for young people? How can we turn that around so we can raise a generation that doesn't get that indoctrination and that can grow up knowing Islamic history?
No, I'm not the solution to this. I'm saying this is a problem of the woman. I don't have the solution to this. I myself am putting a little grain there of, you know, of sand in the critical Muslim studies we're doing here in Granada for 2 weeks, etc. We're trying to put a little grain of sand there, but that cannot be solved by one person or two persons. This is a project that needs to be taken seriously, you know, by the woman, and especially by people with some kind of intellectual preparation inside the UMA that will take seriously all this historiography that we have absorbed as if it was, we took it for granted, and now we are repeating in crazy ways, you know. And so these kind of things, we need to go back into that. We need to go back into the moments, you know, British colonialism, French colonialism, their effects on the countries, Muslim majority countries, how that have affected certain versions of Islam that today are run around as authentic and so on. You know, so we need to go back and revise many things. And I see the project of Kyle as that attempt also of trying to address these challenges. You know, so you know, I see what we're doing in this table and in this week as precisely an attempt to try, and this is where I see the connection between critical Muslim studies and Kyle. I see the connection of trying to, okay, let's look back at the sources, let's look back and let's do, like Tariqa always remind us, it's not Islam that needs to create for reformation. It's us, the Muslims, that need to be reformed. So it's a Muslim reform. It's not an Islamic reform. And this is very important, okay? Because what we're trying to do is not reforming Islam. Islam is perfect. We don't need a reform of Islam. But we need a reform of ourselves, okay? So in that sense, we need to come with a decolonial view to be able to do this shift, taking seriously the tradition, taking seriously all of this, but within the context, again, I always put that there, within the context of Western modernity to understand how that tradition, we cannot take it as something pure. It's something that has been affected by that history in a fundamental way. And we need to then grab that history to understand what is it from Islam that we can bring back today, okay, as a tool to face the problems humanity faces, okay, to bring solutions to the problems of humanity. Okay? But if you don't do the critical decolonial work, what happens is that it could easily happen that you take things from there that are not necessarily Islamic, that are just a decree passed by a French military occupier of Morocco in the 19th century, and now today pass as something authentic from Islam. You get the point? Take it as a metaphor.
I'm happy that the sister asked this question. Actually, my question is, before talking about how we should teach our kids about this, my question is, on the personal level, how to deconstruct those paradigms, this European Eurocentric narrative that you talk about, because you seem to say that it's kind of omnipresent in the history production. So what do I do next time I open or buy a history book? How can I get rid of it? Because you're saying it's inside us, and as any paradigm, I guess we can't really notice it.
Okay, I can give you a few examples, very brief, because that's a seminar of many hours. But very brief, I can give you a few examples, okay? The binaries the West have constructed, let's take a few of them, okay? One of them is to say that the Europeans are naturally and inherently scientific. Non-Europeans are naturally and inherently non-scientific, superstitious, blah, blah, blah. The West is naturally and inherently for women's liberation. The non-West is naturally and inherently patriarchal, etc., etc. You could go over all these things, okay? There are many responses to that you can give to that, okay? One of the responses could be to say, okay, let's take the binary as such, accept it as such, okay, and just invert it like this, okay? Just invert it, okay? That's one plausible reaction, okay? And then you are going to justify, okay, in the eyes of that challenge that is coming from the West, these are questions coming from the West, okay? These are not your questions. Then you fall there in that conversation, you enter the conversation, you accept the premise that Muslims are the worst patriarchal people in the world, okay?
You don't notice that you accepted it.
Huh?
You don't notice that you accepted it.
Yes, but because now you're going to find ways to justify it, okay? Now you're going to find and say, yes, we are like this, and this is better than what you have, okay? And then you turn the whole discussion into accepting the binary, just inverting it, okay? Now, if you invert the binary, you're still within the Eurocentric binary. You get the point?
Yeah.
You haven't displaced the binary, okay? You haven't questioned this premise that Islam is this and this and that, and the West is this and this and that. You haven't questioned. You just put in place where the West was here, superior, and the other tradition here, only thing you did was to do like this. Accept the characterization, and then put your tradition as superior to the West. You get the point? The moment you do that, you fall into the traps. And now you are in a Eurocentric discussion in the name of some kind of authentic Islam. This is where Western modernity is very successful, because they put the questions to you that are not necessarily your questions, but then you are in the position of having to defend yourself, and then there are two possibilities. One is to just invert the binary and say, no, my tradition is superior to yours, and it's true. I am this, this, and that, whatever the West say, and you only do like this. And then you're going to find the hadiths, the thing, etc., to justify the whole thing, okay? The other alternative that you could see that a lot is people who then accept the binary, but instead of inverting it and putting the one inferior into the superior side, leaving intact the binary, okay, will say, yes, we need to catch up with the West. Let's imitate the West. You see? That's the other alternative. Get the point? So, what I'm trying to say is that we need to take a step back, look at these binaries that the West are putting there, okay, and develop our own agenda surpassing these binaries instead of taking them as the, you know, the source from which you're going to now be responding. Be either to accept and say, yes, the West is better, let's catch up, or to just invert it and say, no, the West is worse, and what the West is saying is not true. We are the ones who are the superior, and you see, and then you invert the binary using the same characterization West, that the West has thrown on you, and you have accepted. You get the point? So how do you break away with that? You need to be critical of Western modernity, you see, and look at these traps, you see, and how these traps have colonized from the interior of our tradition. Another example is the concept of the universal. Why are we using the concept of universal in the way the West has been using it? You have certain version of Islam that sounds like Western preaching, okay, of the uni that defines for the right what is good for you. Do you get the point? Is when in Islam, one of the beautiness of Islam is the possibility of this diversity, the recognition of all the prophets, okay? Why is not being affirmed this pluriversality as universality? You see, the diversity within unity, the notion of Tawhid, okay? Why this is not emphasized in this way? Why is it that suddenly we have notion of Tawhid that sounds like, you know, unity with homogeneity, without diversity? One that defines for the rest what is good for you. Exactly the same notion of universality of Western colonial projects. You get the point? Where is this coming from? Well, this is coming from, again, colonization of the West inside the tradition, okay, to now coming to haunt you, okay? Because now you have readings that becomes that start doing this kind of universalism. And if you don't agree with me, or you don't agree with the way I think of Allah, I kill you. You get the point? And I'm justified because, you know, in the name of Allah, whatever, okay? So you have this kind of perverse readings that I identify as coming from with Western modernity. Of course you can tell me, listen, I can trace back to you in history that in the Muslim world, this happened here, that happened there, that is resembles this thing. Yes, but the problem is that we cannot dehistoricize the moments in history in which the Ummah existed, okay? What that means is that you need to understand that yes, there were versions maybe similar, but they were not as powerful as they have become today. Okay? And how they became today so powerful? Well, because Western modernity, imperial colonial projects that are putting financing and sustaining this kind of versions of Islam, okay? And yes, in the past you could find everything in the past. And then what you cannot do is say, this perverse interpretation of Islam is coming from that other group that was 1,300 years ago saying this same thing over there. You cannot do that. And the reason you cannot do that is because there are discontinuities in forms of political authority and social systems. And so you cannot collapse what happened in one place with what happened in another just like that. Okay? Because after 1492, there's a huge rupture here, a metaphysical catastrophe that transform everything, the way we think, our identities, the name we name territories, Europe, Africa, Latin America, these were concepts did not exist there. Even that was transformed, the way we call the territories we live, okay? All of that was transformed, our identity, our ways of thinking, our everything. Because as I said before, Western modernity went after your subjectivity, after your soul. It's not just a form of power that governs, it's a form of power that goes beyond governing. It goes into touching your soul, touching your subjectivity, your ways of thinking, your ways of being, etc., etc. And so you cannot de-link these processes, okay, and making the trans-historical problem that the Muslims have since I don't know what, you know, and make the Muslims the main causation or responsible of the problems. I don't want to fall into that trap because I think that is Western modernity, a major causation, the imperial colonial power, the major causations of the problem we live today and of the problem that Muslims are victim of in most of the world, socially victim, okay? At the same time that we have to acknowledge also that we have agency that we can act, you know, that we are also agents to transform history and transform whatever is going on there, okay? And at the same time that we can say that we have some responsibility, but it's a secondary responsibility to the major problem, which is the Western colonial imperial power, okay, that have colonized most of the world.
We have less than 10 minutes. Dr. Shinqiti.
It's working now?
Yes.
Thank you very much for the very insightful talks. I think there is much need, there are a lot of honesty with self needed when you talk about this intercultural interaction, civilizational interaction between the Islamic world and the West. Though actually today, the West is in the Islamic world and the Islamic world is in the West. And I think Gian Esposito is right when he said one time that it's hard now to talk about Islam and the West because you have Islam in the West, not Islam and the West. So, but I think we probably need more self-confidence because self-confidence leads to openness and less self-confidence leads to sometimes rejection, fanaticism, defensiveness. Dr. Abdul Hakim Murad of Cambridge has a very nice article titled "The Poverty of Fanaticism." It's that the fanatics think they are protecting themselves, but actually they are impoverishing themselves. So when you get when we get over reacting and over protecting of the identity, we are impoverishing our own identity. The more you are open, the more you enrich yourself. You need to enrich yourself without losing yourself. You have this challenge, it's a double challenge. You have to protect your identity, but you cannot protect it by just closing the doors. No, you protect it, but you enrich it. I think it was Kurt Levi-Strauss who said that creativity appears only on the borders between cultures. So you need those borders. And that's why you probably find people who have more than one culture, more than one language, that are more creative because of this. They are living on these borders. And this is very important to keep in with all of our fears about identity and the Western hegemony. I think we need also to know that civilization is always synthesis. It was never built out of one element or one culture. If Muslims in their golden age were not open to Greek, Chinese, Indian, Persian, all kinds of traditions, they would never be able to build their civilization. And that's true for the West in the time of Renaissance. And now we know how much it owes to Islamic culture, whether here in Spain or through other gates. Sicily, even during the Crusade, there was some cultural interaction. So I think how to reconcile these two responsibilities, responsibility of protecting identity and responsibility of enriching yourself, protecting yourself and enriching yourself. That's the challenge. Last point is we need to contribute to the modern civilization, not to replace it. No civilization replaced others. They always contribute, develop the existing civilization. Even if they try to annihilate the previous civilization, you will never be able. The Mosque of Cordoba is still a mosque. It's called the Cathedral, the Mosque Cathedral, the name itself, the Mosque Cathedral. They call it what in Spanish? Mesquita Cathedral, right? Means the cathedral of the mosque. And Hagia Sophia is still a cathedral also, even if it's a mosque, but it's a mosque. We still have this Byzantine Christian art inside. And so no civilization can replace or annihilate another, specifically today. And I think we need to think in terms of contribution more than in terms of replacement. We need to reject hegemony, but we should not come with hegemony alternative. Thanks.
I would like to, with all respect, reply to this.
You always like to
no, I
to flat.
Yeah, I would like to reply.
Thank you so much.
Just to say we have 3 minutes. Will it
I just want to say the following. I think there might be a misunderstanding here again in the communication, because the problem is the following. When you talk about contributing to a civilization, I don't want to contribute to a civilization of death. Our responsibility as Muslims is to transform this civilization into a new one that will affirm life, okay? And that will affirm la ilaha illallah, okay? It's not to be part of something that is destructive of life. So I don't want to contribute to a Western civilization that is destructive of human life in the millions, okay? And destructive of life in general. All the species are at stake here. This is why indigenous people, aboriginal people call this a civilization of death. I don't want to contribute to that. If I do that as a Muslim, I'll become a colonial Muslim. I won't become really...
Well, I think it's a very sweeping generalization to call civilization. It's not civilization of death or life. It's both. And it saved millions of lives and killed millions of lives. Just simple as that.
Civilization in the past have put us in this situation.
How many lives were saved because of the work of Pasteur, for example? Or discovery of antibiotic or anything. This civilization saved millions of lives and killed, take millions of lives. So just to look at it from two sides. Okay. I like to look at
when you look
the side of the coin.
Okay, this is interesting because when you look at the Mosque of Cordoba, you're seeing that no civilization can destroy another. That's what your point. I'm saying the Mosque of Cordoba is empty. Muslims were killed, exterminated. That's why there's no Muslims in Spain from those times. What you have are the convert Muslims reason or the migrants. They were all exterminated. So am I going to now see the museum, okay, where Muslims cannot go there and pray? If you try to go there and pray, they'll put you in jail, okay? So don't even try. So is that why we're going to celebrate an empty box there that they call it a mosque just to bring tourists like us Muslims to go there and pay for the Spanish economy? Is this what we want to do? No, this is a symbol of a destruction of a civilization and replacing it by something else. That's why it's empty. I don't want this. This is not a good example if you want to make this point, okay? And the second thing is that I'm not arguing that, of course, we have to learn from each other. We have to learn from cultures, knowledge, whoever produces it, it's no problem. But there is a difference, okay, between Western civilization learning from other civilizations and acknowledging it and say we learned this from the school of Baghdad, we learned this from Averroes, we learned this for, you know, and go over the list and recognize this and then move on. It's no problem with that. But the perversity of Western modernism is to say the following. I take your knowledge, okay? I use it for my own purpose, and then I claim that the original of this knowledge, these people here, I erase you from the history, and then make a claim that these people are superior, we are superior, because we created the knowledge. This is what I'm criticizing. I'm not criticizing learning from other people. I mean, it's great to learn from other cultures. I don't know why you're hitting. There is a miscommunication here, because you're hitting me as if I'm opposed to dialogues of cultures and things like that. I'm not opposed to that. We can learn.
I was not replying to you, by the way.
Okay, I'm open to learning from other people. What I disagree and what I find perverse is when you have a civilization that still, not only resources, but still the knowledge of the rest of humanity, and then recycle it as if it was originally and naturally from Western men. Okay, erase the memory of where this knowledge are coming from, and then recycle them as something naturally and inherently European. That's perverse. That's perverse. And that's what I call epistemicide. Epistemicide, you destroy the knowledge of the others, appropriate what you want to take from them, and then come back and say, you know what, I'm going to teach you science, because you don't know Islam and science, Islam and modernity, Islam and democracy, Islam and us, you know, and then put us to discuss things that are absurd. We are in absurd conversations in that sense, because we have swallowed, you know, the whole historiography of Eurocentrism, you know, and then we take the problematics and the question they pose and take them seriously as it was a problem of the Muslims. I'm sorry, it's not a problem of the Muslims. It's a problem of Western modernity, and it's a problem of the Muslim the moment we take those narratives for granted and seriously. We shouldn't take them seriously. We should just go beyond them and think beyond them and not take seriously this kind of Western-centric, Eurocentric narrative. And this is the decolonial, where we have to then look back and in a critical way, not only to the West, but to ourselves, and see how are we swallowing all this crazy narrative as if it was taken for granted. So I don't want to contribute to a civilization of death. I want to transform it, as a Muslim, we have that responsibility. We cannot be affirming, if we take justice seriously, this kind of projects that are just killing Muslims in the millions. Look at the counting that happened did yesterday. Look at the counting, millions of Muslims killed in the last 15 years between Iraq, Afghanistan, and et cetera, et cetera, and the drones thrown in Yemen everywhere. You start counting, we're talking about millions of civilians killed, okay? And not to talk about all the millions I mentioned in the first day, Christians are killed you, civilized are killed you, developers are killed you, and today Democrats are killed you. These are all Western colonial projects in 500 years that have killed more human beings than any other civilization in human history. This is what I am calling attention to. Now, you can then come with the vaccine, okay? You can then come with a few things that you have developed after stealing the knowledge of the rest of the world. And of course, you have the infrastructure now to now develop science, and now, you know, anybody else, the rest of the world, you have destroyed the infrastructure, so people cannot do science as good as you, because you have all the resources of the world concentrated in your hands. And now you will come and claim, oh, you know, we save a few lives.
Say a short comment. Say a short comment.
Last comment.
Okay.
What
I'm warning about is just simply overreaction. And I remember some of what Malik Bennaby said about the Spanish ball, said sometimes he said some people are just playing with Muslims the game of the Spanish ball, so they raise to them this red flag, and the ball, you know, starts, you know, trying to hit Lu'bat Thor, Las Panas. So until they exhaust their energy of overreaction. So whether every human being, and it's very normal to have self-protection. It's very normal for any culture and identity to protect itself. But when we overreact, I think that doesn't lead to a healthy relation with the rest of humanity. And we are the one who's going to pay the price because we need to learn.
But I'm not overreacting. I'm not calling attention to problems, so we face them. I have no fear, brother. I have no fear.
And nobody has fear.
I'm not acting out of fear.
Nobody has fear.
Right. And so if I have fear, I won't be talking because I live in the United States of America, okay? And there are all these laws that can put me in jail in a second. If I have fear, I won't be talking this way.
I've been here 14 years.
I'll be hiding somewhere also in the city, okay?
Yeah.
But I have no fear, okay? I am talking, you know, honestly, what I feel is important for us to look at, you know, not out of fear or reaction, is how are we going to build a better world, which is the spirit that Tariq put forward here the first day. How are we going to build a better world? Are we going to build a better world contributing to the worst of Western civilization?
Okay, just one sentence. I think, just one sentence. There is a need. The West has not been an honest teacher for Muslims, but Muslims have not been able to be a humble student.
Okay,
in this modern
time. With this. We don't have any time anymore, so it's already too late. So let's take the rest of the question informally, and thank you very much.
Yes. Hello. You wanted to say something,
Bichir?
Okay.
Well, actually, I agree completely with you. And
with whom?
With you.
Ah, with me.
Well, I don't reject what Dr. Shankiti said.
No, you have to agree with one of us.
Okay. And I would like to come back to what Sister just said before, because I mean we are here, we are gathered, and even if all of us we are kind of educated, and we were not aware of about what you said. I mean, all this Western vision inside us, we're not aware of about it. So we really need to bring this knowledge and this vision to the all over the Arab world and the Muslim world to the next generation. Otherwise, the coming generation will grow up like us, and even it's worse. And if they are not aware about this Western inside us, we're not going to contribute to anything. So I really think that we have to
make an effort
and disperse this knowledge where the best we can all over the communities we live in, and that's it.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll leave it here, inshallah. So inshallah, we see you tomorrow at 9 o'clock. Thank you, Dr. Raymond. Thank you, Raymond.
Assalamu alaikum. I love to our brother.